On June the 5th, 1973, during his broadcast over CFRB Toronto, Mr. Gordon Sinclair, one of Canada's most respected broadcasters, had some thoughts concerning his American neighbors. These are his words. The United States dollar has taken another pounding on German, French, and British exchanges, hitting the lowest point ever known in West Germany. It has declined there by 41% since 1971. And this Canadian thinks it's time to speak up for the Americans as the most generous and possibly the least appreciated people in all the earth. As long as 60 years ago, when I first started to read newspapers, I read of floods on the Yellow River and the Yangtze. Who rushed in with men and money to help? The Americans did. That's who. They've helped control floods on the Nile, the Amazon, the Ganges, and the Niger. Today, the rich bottomland of the Mississippi is underwater, and no foreign land has sent a dollar to help. Germany, Japan, and to a lesser extent, Britain and Italy were lifted out of the debris of war by the Americans, who poured in billions of dollars and forgave other billions in debts. None of those countries is today paying even the interest on its remaining debts to the United States. When the franc was in danger of collapsing in 1956, it was the Americans who propped it up, and their reward was to be insulted and swindled on the streets of Paris. I was there. I saw it. When distant cities are hit by earthquakes, it's the United States that hurries in to help. Managua, Nicaragua is one of the most recent examples. So far this spring, 59 American communities have been flattened by tornadoes. Nobody has helped. The Marshall Plan, the Truman Policy, all pump billions upon billions of dollars into discouraged countries. And now newspapers in those countries are writing about the decadent, war-mongering Americans. I'd like to see just one of those countries that is gloating over the erosion of the United States dollar build its own airplanes. Come on, let's hear it. Does any other country in the world have a plane to equal the Boeing Jumbo Jet, the Lockheed TriStar, or the Douglas 10? If so, why don't they fly them? Why do all international lines except Russia fly American planes? Why does no other land on Earth even consider putting a man or a woman on the moon? You talk about Japanese technocracy and you get radios. You talk about German technocracy and you get automobiles. You talk about American technocracy and you find men on the moon, not once, but several times, and safely home again. You talk about scandals and the Americans put theirs right in the store window for everybody to look at. Even the draft dodgers are not pursued and hounded. They're right here on our streets in Toronto. Most of them, unless they're breaking Canadian laws, are getting American dollars from mom and dad at home to spend here in Canada. When the Americans get out of this bind, as they will, who could blame them if they said, to hell with the rest of the world. Let someone else build or repair foreign dams or design foreign buildings that won't shake apart in earthquakes. When the railways of France, Germany, and India were breaking down through age, it was the Americans who rebuilt them. When the Pennsylvania Railroad and the New York Central went broke, nobody loaned them an old caboose. Both are still broke. I can name you 5,000 times when the Americans raced to the help of other people in trouble. Can you name me even one time when someone else raced to the Americans in trouble? I don't think there was outside help even during the San Francisco earthquake. Our neighbors have faced it alone, and I'm one Canadian who's damn tired of hearing them kicked around. They will come out of this thing with their flag high, and when they do, they're entitled to thumb their nose at the lands that are gloating over their present troubles. I hope Canada is not one of these. And another thing, recently the American Red Cross was told at its 48th annual meeting in New Orleans that it was broke. This year's disasters, with the year less than half over, has taken it all. And nobody, but nobody, has helped.
Well, I saw the thing coming out of the sky. It had a one long horn and one big eye. Like a Mr. Shaking in the city. It looks like a purple people eater to me. It was a one-eyed, one-horned, flying purple people eater.
One-eyed, one-horned, flying purple people eater.
A one-eyed, one-horned, flying purple people eater. Sure looks strange to me.
One-eyed.
Well, really came down to earth and he lit in a tree. I said, Mr. Purple People Eater, don't eat me. I heard him say in a voice so gruff,
I wouldn't eat you, cause you're so tough.
It was a one-eyed, one-horned, flying purple people eater.
One-eyed, one-horned, flying purple people eater.
One-eyed, one-horned, flying purple people eater. Sure looks strange to me.
One horn?
I said, Mr. Purple People Eater, what's your line? He said, eating purple people, and it sure is fine. But that's not the reason that I came to land.
Rock and roll band.
Well, bless my soul, rock and roll, flying purple people eater. Pigeon toed undergrowth, flying purple people eater.
We wear short shorts.
Friendly little people eater. What a sight to see.
Oh!
And then he swung from the tree and he lit on the ground. And he started to rock, really rocking around. It was a crazy ditty with a swinging tune.
Sing a bop.
Hey, bless my soul, rock and roll, flying purple people eater. Pigeon toed undergrowth, flying purple people eater.
I like short shorts.
Flying purple people eater.
What a sight to see.
Purple people.
Well, he went on his way, and then what do you know? I saw him last night on a TV show. He was blowing it out, really knocking him dead. Playing rock and roll music through the horn in his head.